This is a request in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I see that in our church. It's hard really to praise our God just with amen. Our amen is so weak, and I don't know how we feel that. Just think about it. When we see those who do not praise God, when they hear a nice song like this, everybody responds with joy. Those who prepared this song, they did it for their God and for you. We are in the sanctuary where we should humble ourselves, forget who we are, and praise our God. It's hard for us just to say amen. Sometimes I feel, Lord, are we really ready for you? If the angels can forget who they are and praise him with joy, what about us? I'm asking you, my brothers and sisters, when we hear and when they are done with their song, we need you to say that amen. Even if you have to explode, explode for the glory of your God. Even when they do this program, it's a really special program. May God bless you. Amen.
Amen. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Merry Christmas.
We will be reading a poem called A Christmas Dream. 'Twas the night before Christmas, and all over the earth a spark of peace flickers, a sense of new birth. Could the hope of this season really come true, that love would increase all the world through? I had just settled down, drifting into a dream. Visions were flowing, a wonderful stream.
A canvas of faces, black, yellow, brown, white, men, women, and children all come into sight. A symphony of languages creating a song that sounds like the voice of an angelic throng. The image unfolds, the dream now seems clear. What once seemed elusive appears to draw near.
Brothers and sisters walk hand in hand, no walls to divide, no hate in the land. Faces are seen, no prejudice hide, the precious creation that God placed inside. The color of skin does not frighten or blind. All see the beauty of heart, soul, and mind.
No child fears abuse by night or by day. Instead, they move freely in streets as they play. Families grow stronger, forgiveness abounds. Kind words soon outweigh the cruel, harmful sounds. People see needs of those far and near, sharing and giving and spreading good cheer.
Religion no longer is used as a frame to justify personal power or fame. The sounds and the anguish of bombs fade away like snow that soon melts on a bright sunny day. And then all at once I stirred in my bed, glimmers of joy and hope filled my head.
I sat up reflecting and hear a voice call. Could there be peace on earth now for all? How can this be? I quickly replied. For hate and distrust push all peace aside. Then suddenly through the tears I clearly see, for the dream to come true, it must start with me.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
It's always my luck I get to follow something like that. Okay. Praise the Lord. That was absolutely beautiful.
Amen. We're reading a, I guess you'd call it a play, but it's only two people, and yeah, called He Came to Get Messy by Tommy Woodward. Woodard. How would you pronounce that?
Works for me.
And while they were there, the time came for a baby to be born, and she gave birth to her first son, her firstborn, a son. And she wrapped in cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
God had this messy plan, a plan to save the world. And to do that, he was going to send a son. Where does the God of the universe send his son? Where does the King of Kings and Lord of Lords come? To a barn, a stable, a manger of all places. Certainly no place fit for a king. But then again, this wasn't any ordinary king. When I say it was messy, I mean messy. It was a barn, a stable. So you've got animals and animal stuff. Manure, mud. It's an awful, pitiful place for people, much less the King of Kings to be born. So why would God do that? Well, I can't necessarily tell you for sure, because the prophet Isaiah tells us that his thoughts are not our thoughts and his ways are not our ways.
But that same prophet, 400 years before, said, "All we like sheep have gone astray, each of us to our own way, and that the Lord has laid our iniquities on him." You see, Jesus came to a messy place, a barn. Well, yes, that's messy, but he came to a messy world. Why? Because a shepherd was coming to take care of his sheep and to prepare a way for his sheep to go home. That's what a shepherd does. He lives where the sheep are. He sleeps where they sleep and eats where they eat. That got Jesus in trouble. Why did Jesus eat with the sinners? Because that's what a shepherd does.
An angel appeared to the shepherds in the field and said, "This will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in clothes, lying in a manger." The Apostle Paul would later write that we should have the same attitude of Jesus Christ, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, becoming a servant, being made in human likeness.
You see, being a servant is messy, and Jesus set this incredible example for us. I mean, he got down on his knees and he washed feet. The God of the universe, the God who deserved the best of everything, got on his knees. He's the God who came to the world and was laid in a manger, a feeding trough of all places. Why such a messy place? He was following a messy plan.
So needless to say, that very first Christmas was dirty.
It was grimy.
It was filthy.
But thank God it was, because without it,
what a mess we'd be in.
Well, it'd just be my luck. I have to follow Corey and Shan. You know, one of my favorite authors, Sister White, she had a great deal to say about the birth of our Savior. This passage I have selected this morning goes with our theme that Corey and Cheyenne just read their passage about. Comes to us from The Desire of Ages. I believe it's pages 48 and 49 if you want to go back through and examine that yourself in this holiday season. "Heaven and earth are no wider apart today than when shepherds listen to the angel's song. Humanity is still as much the object of heaven's solicitude as when common men of common occupations met angels at noonday and talked with the heavenly messengers in the vineyards and the fields. To us, in the common walks of life, heaven may be very near. Angels from the courts above will attend the steps of those who come to go at God's command. The story of Bethlehem is an exhaustless theme. It is hidden the depth of the riches of both the wisdom and knowledge of God." Romans 11:33. "We marvel at the Savior's sacrifice in exchanging the throne of heaven for the manger. and the companionship of adoring angels for the beasts of the stall. Human pride and self-sufficiency stand rebuked at his presence. Yet this was but the beginning of his wonderful condescension. It would have been an almost infinite humiliation for the Son of God to take man's nature, even when Adam stood in his innocence in Eden. But Jesus accepted humanity when the race had been weakened by 4,000 years of sin. Like every child of Adam, he accepted results of the working of the hereditary, of the great law of heredity. With all these results were his shown in history of his earthly ancestors. He came with such a heredity to share our sorrows and temptations and to give us the example of a sinless life. Satan in heaven had hated Christ for his position in the courts of God. He hated him more when he himself was dethroned. He hated him who pledged himself to redeem a race of sinners. Yet, into the world where Satan claimed dominion, God permitted his Son to come, a helpless babe, subject to the weakness of humanity. He permitted him to meet life's peril in common with every human soul, to fight the battle as every child of humanity must fight it at the risk of failure and eternal loss. The heart of the human father yearns over his son. He looks into the face of his little child and trembles at the thought of life's peril. He longs to shield his dear one from Satan's power, to hold him back from temptation and conflict, to meet a bitterer conflict and a more fearful risk. God gave his only begotten son, that the path of life may be made sure for our little ones. Herein is love. Wonder, O heavens, be astonished, O earth.
Amen.
I feel it's more appropriate for me to say, aloha. Good, I'm glad you've been back home where I came from. It's good to be back here. It's nice to know you have no snow, but I don't mind. I left the snow there. And I really appreciate what we've been displaying here with the talents of our young people, amen? And what is transpiring in our culture and in the world with our youngins. I do wish I could have accompanied myself as well. That was a tremendous job. This is the season that we have sung so many different names of who Christ is. And this morning, if you will permit me, because I think I'm the only one that has an accompaniment that's on electronics, and I have to make sure I can hear my accompaniment. However, the words to this song, I want to challenge you as we are stated in words of Christ in his book and in Revelation of who he really is. And I'd like to make sure that I magnify, with the Lord's help, the reason for this season.
I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I am the root of David. I'm the bright and morning star. I am the Lion of Judah. I am, I am.
Okay. So I'm toward the end after all this fabulous stuff, and I hope you also will get a blessing from what I'm going to share with you. Oh, I'm so blessed. I'm so filled. Praise the Lord for his gift. Jesus Christ, the greatest gift of all. I think most of us have heard about the golden rule. Do unto others as you would want them to do unto you. But how about Christ, what he did for us? When he came for us, he gave us more than what we probably deserve. He treated us better than we treated him, let's say, like historically. Okay, let's go back. So how about when we pay it forward, we treat others better than what we think we want to be treated? I have a little poem for you. It's called The Christmas Lesson. Christmas is a special time to give, to serve, to love. It isn't just about yourself, but others that you think of. The presents, the trees, the glowing lights are fun but have no part in what the real meaning of Christmas is that is in your heart. Even if other people don't, you should try to do the things that you would want them to do to you. The holidays are a busy time, but they're sometimes good because they keep you thinking about others like you should. So this year, try not to think about yourself, but think of the things you can do to help others have a wonderful Christmas. And you'll find that you'll be happy too.
Christine.
teacher Abel for the closing hymn.
Good Christian friends, rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Give heed to what we say. Jesus Christ is born today. Oxen as before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today.
Heavenly Father, thank you for all your blessings. Thank you for guiding us through this special program. Where we fail, Jesus Christ among us. And in your name, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we may be prepared for his coming. And when we go home, when we leave the sanctuary, be with us through this special season. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.